Good afternoon, good morning, or good evening, everybody, depending where you are, let's say on the globe. So I'm Giuseppe Volpe, as Fernando said. I'm originally Italian, located now in Austria, working for Magna Powertrain. I really like the opportunity about speaking a bit more into details about eMotor development. And definitely one thing that is a focus for each of us as eMachine designer is the simulation worlds against the reality. We know there are some links, of course, we always try to get closer and closer to the reality, but there is always somehow a boundary. And I think it was important to try to tackle some insight together. And that's why what I would like to do today with you is to start have a look at a brief introduction about Magna Powertrain and what we do. That serves me for introducing some automotive solutions and really allows me to focus on some specific machines I would like to discuss with you today that we develop. So take the advantage of these machines for going into more details about the workflow. So in the first part, I will focus on the design phase and then going to the test bench and how we can get back from the test bench, what we can learn from the test bench and how we can learn from it. And I will then go through, I think, a very good example of optimization that was performed by one of my colleagues in the past. That shows us a bit of how we decide which machine topology is good for what, and is always correct to generalize this conclusion. One thing I will do also during this presentation is also to give you a bit more details about future work that we're doing what we do in my department, in my team, which is the Advanced Engineering eMotor team. So let's get started with some words about Magna. Magna is quite a large company where we have a vision of trying really to advance mobility for everybody, for making it available for everybody and everything. With around 37.8 billion sales and 344 manufacturing plants across the globe, we are a bit more than 181,000 people. Depending on the period of the year in which you have looked at this number, we are the number one suppliers in North America for automotive application and the fourth or the third one in globally. What makes our link between 180,000 people is the mission. Definitely, we try to work together to create a better world of mobility and responsibility. So really looking after the environment, and we are really committed to make a difference. So not just by word, but really looking into that through our product process and people. A clear example of that is definitely the target of carbon neutrality in European emissions and operations by 2025 and for global operation in 2030. So this is the big family of Magna. It's a big company, and there are different divisions within Magna. One of them is called Magna Powertrain. As the name can tell you, we focus in Magna Powertrain on the powertrain development. What we do here, we do pretty much everything from the feasibility study, from the concept definition through the product development, testing, and then serialization. So here you can see, let's say, some pictures starting from top left about, of course, some CAD designs, so our initial design stages. Then we go through the different stages of the design to the prototype, then we go to test bench. So you can see on the top right picture, the test of a full axle. And then we go, of course, to full vehicle testing that you can see at the bottom left picture, one of our facility in which we test the entire vehicle before going, of course, to serial production and looking after our customer in after sales. In terms of number here in Magna Powertrain, we are around 21,000 people distributed across the globe. And later on, I will give you a bit more insight if I get the chance. But let's focus on the interesting part. So let's focus on the automotive solutions before we go into details about the e-machine designs, the different concept of the designs. Let's focus on the present, which are the solution, which are the topology of the machines that we have, and let's use one of them to focus on the design process and calibration process, and then we'll focus on two of them, so a PSM and an induction machine, in the second part in which we will have a look at optimization and comparison studies. For going into details about the different machine topologies, I really like this overview, which shows a bit the process of going from conventional internal combustion engines to the electrifications. Why I say this? Because, of course, we've been involved a lot in conventional business, and we are moving farther and faster in the eDrive. And the first step into that, as we all know, has been hybrid electric vehicles. In this case, for example, here you see two cases, which is the Magna Intelligence Eco and Intelligence Command, which are focusing on plug-in hybrid vehicle. We started here developing different solutions. In one case, which is the Intelligence Eco, which is focusing on reducing, of course, the emissions, increasing the efficiency of SUVs with front-wheel drives. And starting from here, we developed a different system, and you will see soon some different machines that we've been looking after before developing what we call Intelligence Command, which is a much more complicated system with both axle, for example, electrified. This has been a path to reach the battery electric vehicle solution. So here you see highlighted in red what I want to discuss with you today. And I will show you two different examples to allow us to reflect on the different machine topologies. So here we'll speak about battery electric vehicles. So in the intelligence reach, for example, we've been focusing on single axle, double axle drives, to really try to combine new technology with software controls and really make the maximum out of it in terms of efficiency and dynamics. The intelligence force, for example, on top right here, we've been focusing a lot on drop-in replacement of pickup truck. So the idea here is to have a full integrated e-axle to be dropped in. And on the bottom right, you see basically the highest power class we've been working on, which focuses a lot on having uncompromised off-road capabilities. I wanted to show this for getting the chance to focus on one or two e-machine development and to draw some conclusions, let's say, together. The first e-machine I want to focus on today, it's what we've been working on for the Volkswagen MEB platform. This has been a work that has been performed, of course, over the years. We've been investigating different solutions before coming to our conclusions. And the background here is we had and we wanted to develop a secondary axle. In this case, you can see it's on the front, so from the top left picture, with the main aim of providing boost performance for mid-size electric vehicles. We, of course, had several optimization loops, several ideas on what would have been the best configuration for this, before reaching out what you see here, which is a very compact and light design, where we try to integrate it, where we integrated everything, let's say, in this system. And of course, where I want to focus my attention today with you is the e-motor. In this case, we opted for an induction machine. In this case, you see the diameter is around 200 millimeters, so the OD, the stator OD. And this machine is able to deliver a peak power of around 80 to 100 kilowatts. What was very good about this is the integration, as said, and the work in terms of packaging and weight. So if we have just a look at this, we may draw some conclusion saying, we've heard a lot, the secondary axle, maybe it's better to have it in the front. If I look just at this slide, at this presentation, I can end up with the conclusion that induction machine may be the best one for the secondary drive. And this is something I really want to focus today. When we speak about electrical machines, configuration, single axle, double axle, it's really difficult, for not saying impossible, to generalize the conclusion that we get on one optimization or the other. So this is a case in which we ended up with this solution for this application, for this customer, for this platform. But let's have a look at the next one. The next one, we developed the entire system. So here with the intelligence reach, we developed the front axle, the rear axle, the controls here, and the connectivity. And here the solution, as you can see, is different. So here you see the rear electric drive system, which is what we call electric drive system mid plus, where we're aiming to a power of around 180, 200 kilowatts with on the rear drive, a torque vectoring. On the front axle, we have another similar machine, a similar system with a decoupling unit that would allow you to think that is something related to a permanent magnet machine. So in this case, we ended up with a completely different system optimization, a completely different vehicle optimization that led us to a complete different solution. And here, of course, we also had the possibility and the flexibility of having the control on the control. So this means that, of course, we can leverage the two drives to get the best out of them in terms of efficiency. So for this application, we ended up with a completely different solution. Also, these systems are in our serial production, and they are, let's say, being optimized really for efficiency, as you can imagine. But of course, you need to be competitive on the market. So cost is always one of the key parameters in the optimizations. And what I want to highlight it is the conclusions that we reached in this case are completely different from the conclusion that we reached in the previous case. This is the state of the art where are we now, and we're going to go into details about this permanent magnet machine in the calibration round. But before we go there, I want to give you also some insight about future development and what we in our team do. Magna Powertrain is focusing a lot on developing new technologies and being ready and more ready for the future. So the advanced engineering team is distributed across the globe. So we are really a global team, distributed between Europe, so mainly Germany and Austria, Asia between China and India, and America between Canada and United States. What we really try here together is to bring together different mindsets, different backgrounds, different approach to problems, and to tackle, of course, the problems from different perspectives. What we do a lot in our advanced engineering eMotor team, I liked to summarize this in three main streams. And let's start here from the middle. We have a good insight about the market. What we see on the market are pretty much conventional machine. 90% of the time, allow me to say that we see nothing surprising there. And this is linked to a history of developing eDrives in the last 10 years, let's say. And the machine pretty much look, I would say, comparable to each other. So here in this main part, in the mainstream, which is in the middle, we're focusing a lot on rethinking about conventional machines that are used nowadays in the eDrives with small changes to try to support as fast as possible the serial production. But we also achieved the conclusion that maybe some decisions that have been done in the past are not valid anymore because the market is changing too fast. So the conventional PM machines that we've been seeing are maybe not the best ones anymore. So on the left side of this slide, you can see what we're doing on the novel permanent magnet topology. So here we started a bit, allow me to say, to rethink about the wheel. So not reinventing the wheel, but questioning the wheel. And here we started again from zero, really thinking a different rotor topology, different stator topologies, different configurations that would enhance our drives for the future. Here you can see between the lines a spoke machine or a V machine, just for example. And on the right-hand side of this picture, you see something which is lately super important, which is independence from rare earth, independence from heavy rare earth, independency from permanent magnets. This is a super high focus in our projects. We are working a lot in terms of pre-development, so advanced engineering and serial production in delivering drives which are more sustainable for the future. Here you can see some picture about synchronous reluctance machine or wound rotor synchronous machines, and several more that we are keeping our attention on to really try to investigate new machine topologies that would allow us to be more independent from rare earth and heavy rare earth. So here what we do, we have a look at different rotor topologies, different machine topologies, different materials, different technologies, different concepts, and we try to bring them together under the same umbrella to really try to make the best out of it. And this you can assume, as you can assume, an important key role is the multi-physics optimization. So here we spend a lot of time in looking at how we can make the best out of the electromagnetic behavior, the mechanical behavior, the thermal behavior. But let's go into details about a typical design workflow before we enter our virtual test bench. Of course, as each of us has got a different workflow for designing eMachines, here I just wanted to highlight a simple high-level design workflow that allows us to discuss about the approach. As you can imagine, there are different tools that we use with high focus on different aspects that allows us to achieve the target in the best way and in the shortest amount of time. Typically, when we approach a problem like this, we start from defining a basic parametric study of our eMachine, starting to understand what we really can get out of the space that we have available. With electromagnetic simulations, getting into more details about losses, drive cycles performance, as you can assume, PWM losses, 3D simulations, and so on. In all these rounds, it's key to keep in mind the cost. Of course, we can get the best machine out with the highest performance, but with the crazy costs. So we would be not competitive. So the cost needs to be always in our head, and we need to look after that. So it's part of our optimization. When we speak about permanent magnet machine, but in general, what is really important is to look after the safe state of our eMachine. So when we speak about permanent magnet machine, the short circuit analysis are the key for avoiding demagnetization, for example. An electromagnetic machine without cooling or without thermal behavior would not last long. So we need to look after the cooling of our machine, the thermal optimization, and to keep into account thermal simulations within our optimization. Torque ripple is part of it. And of course, we need to be sure that the machine stays together. And the key for that is, of course, mechanical strength. When we go to serial production, we need to be sure that the machines that we are delivering to our customer are within the requirements for the entire lifetime. If we're allowing this, what we need to do is what we call tolerance analysis. That means that we understand which are the variability of each parameters that we have, and we double-check that over the entire serial production, we can deliver the performance that our customers are expecting from us. This can take quite a lot of time. Here we can make use, of course, of artificial intelligence or different concepts, but is an important analysis that needs to be done. So let's assume we've been doing this. So we have our requirement. We've been through the design phase. We've designed our machine, taking into account electromagnetic behavior, thermal behavior, and mechanical behavior. And we have our prototype. We have our prototype, and then we enter our testing rooms. Of course, based on the eMachine that we want to test, as you can assume, we have several test benches from 48 volts to 400 volts and to 800 volts. And for a proper study of the electrical machine, of course, we need to be sure that we can partially or fully condition our machine in terms of oil, water, and ambient. So let's assume we have our machine and we are entering now the test bench. How do we start the testing procedure? Let's start first of all with what we call static tests. So we have our machine, which has been delivered by, let's assume, our supplier. And the first thing to double check is the basic ABC. So starting from the DC copper resistance, hopefully it's typically a very good practical idea to have real material measurements. So typically we work with our partners to get the property measured of our steel to be sure that we are testing what we think we are testing. Then we put the machine rotating. So we start spinning up the machine and we start with open circuit tests, typically with the back EMF. This allows, of course, to calibrate and understand how the magnets are performing. Another key important test before starting producing torque is definitely the short circuit test to understand end winding leakage inductances, AC losses, and so on. So the AC losses calibration is another key parameters to be checked, especially when we speak about round wire machine. We know it's also called random wire allocation. So there is a random wire allocation within the slot that makes this value quite variable. Key before the calibration starts is to double check the mechanical losses with what we call cost down tests. And then we're really ready to start measuring our peak performance, continuous performance, and our efficiency maps. So let's assume we've been over the entire cycle here, we are ready to learn from that. How do we learn from that? First of all, what we tend to do is to double check that the geometry is what we expect. So to double check that materials and as we said before, but also the dimensions that we were expecting are corrected. We double check the AC losses and we start introducing the calibrated permanent magnet factors and the lamination properties. We introduce the mechanical losses that we measured and we calibrate resistances and inductances. This is of course a simplified way, but that's how we bring the know-how to our results. At the end of this process, we will get something which is really likely and hopefully closer to the simulation world. So something that is better matching, there is a better match between reality and simulation world. And of course, at each step that we do this, we learn something new. And of course you can assume, and we know, and we see it now, pushing more and more to higher speed and higher torque, the learning is a continuous learning. Pushing higher the voltage, pushing higher the frequency, pushing higher the current, not obviously gives us the same results. So we need to keep on learning. We need to keep on making comparison like this and calibrate our simulations. So this is what we typically do, but let's see this in action. So again, let's assume we designed our permanent magnet machine. We prototyped it and we've been through all this cycle. So let's have a look at some results and let's make together some consideration. We did our measurement on the resistance. So DC resistance is checked and we started spinning up the machine with open circuit tests. Back EMF, as said before, gives a good insight about the magnet properties and what is happening also. Also tells us more about the winding, if the connections are correct, if the number of turns is correct. And if this is all right, typically we should double check at different speed and definitely at different temperatures for fine tuning our magnet properties. Important and key is to calibrate our AC losses. Again, as said, pushing to higher and higher frequencies, and especially when we have round wires machine, we need to double check it. We need to find a way of calibrating our AC losses. What I call AC losses, I'm referring to winding AC losses, so high frequencies losses, and they can be quite challenging. There are different ways of predicting them, starting from analytical ways, going through full FEA methods, passing through hybrid methodologies. And to calibrate them can be quite challenging, especially because at low speed, we have a resistance-limited behavior, while at high speed, they're limited by the inductance's value. So before spinning it up, we typically need to do what we call parameters identification. So understanding our LD, our LQ, our, again, magnets properties. And typically this is done through a different mapping of ID, IQ, and different parameters that we measure. The next step after this is to check the torque, to check the power. That I'm gonna show you in the next slide because I want to focus a lot on that. And the last step is the continuous performance. What I mean with continuous performance? I mean what is possible for the eMachine to deliver for a continuous operating time. This is one of the main challenges that we have because you can easily think about the fact that this takes into account all the physics and all the points we discussed till now, starting from voltage level, resistance, parameters, and in addition to all of this, apart from, of course, losses and so on, we have the heat path exchange and how the cooling system is interacting with that. So here you have an example during the steps of the calibration, so not the final one, but you can see that the magnet temperature between simulation, which is in orange, and red, which is the measured one, get quite close at let's say infinite time, and the winding also is quite close with some small gaps in there. But what I want to focus on is the losses. And before going to losses, let's first have a look at the peak torque that, for example, this machine could deliver. And typically, with a good understanding on which parameters you need to tune, I would say that getting the maximum peak torque quite well aligned between measured and simulation should not be a super high task. So in this example, you can see that since the beginning, we could match it super well. What is much more complicated, and here I wanted to bring this example because I would like to reflect maybe and give a takeaway, if I can somehow, to the audience. So here on the left bottom, you can see an efficiency map, which has been normalized till the peak torque and till the peak speed. So one is the maximum speed, one is the maximum torque. What do I want to bring with this example? So here we see the efficiency difference in terms of percentage. And you see that there is not super big differences. So we have 0.2, 0.3 plus minus. In some cases, it goes to 0.5. But what is clear from this picture is that, so in red, here we have that measured efficiency is lower than expected or than simulated, while the green one means that simulated efficiency is lower than reality. And here, a clear message that brings me out, I mean, that I receive from this picture and for reflecting about this, is that more we push to higher speed and more we push to higher torque, more complicated is to have the same knots for tuning our efficiency map for the entire map. What I mean with this, I mean that probably there are some key parameters that are affecting the low speed area and the low torque area, which are not the same key parameters that are affecting the high speed and the high torque region. For this purpose, more we push and stretch this characteristic up and down, more we need to focus on different regions, more we need to go into more details and more detailed analysis, for example, on what is happening with the real currents that we're pushing in this machine at low speed and at low torque. Is the same behavior and is the same way that the steel is reacting at high speed and high torque, or at high speed continuous performance? The answer is simply no. And more we push into these two directions, which is torque and speed, more this will become complicated. It would allow, I mean, would require us to focus more and more on this topic. The last thing I would like to speak about is an optimization example. And here, I really would like to speak about this work that has been done by one of my colleagues, which is Edwin Howard, that did a very nice, interesting job and study here that allowed me to really think about how a different perspective can bring to different conclusions. So even if we look exactly at the same picture, which is what is happening in a few minutes, we will take something out which is completely different. So let's have a look at the study. We did in the past, as I think each of us did, some study comparison. For in this case, we were focusing on a low-cost secondary eDrive. And here, we wanted to figure out, is it better if you use an induction machine? Is it better if you use a permanent magnet machine? Here, what I'm gonna show you and what Edwin tried to do was to focus now on this round on the induction machine. We're speaking about an 800 volt system with a water glycol cooling system. We will see later on also an oil path. For this optimization at stage, we were focusing on motor cut and OptiSlang, and we were mainly focusing on electromagnetic and thermal behavior. Here you can see some parameters and some boundary conditions about the exercise and the study. And here you can see some optimization approach. So who of you is not too familiar with OptiSlang? It's a tool that allows a meta-modeling approach, which we used here, that is shown in the top right picture. And we used it in linked with ANSYS MotorCAD. Here on the bottom, you can see some results. In total, I think, around 30,000 machines were evaluated with around 2,500 feasible design that came out, and around 100 validated and feasible design. But this is what I really want to discuss, and then I will give the floor for Q&A. Here, what we see on these two pictures, on the left, we see power against speed. On the right, we see torque against speed. In terms of points, what you see is PC, CC, that stands for peak corner, continuous corner, PM and CM, that stands for peak medium, continuous medium speed, C70, which is at 70% of the maximum speed, and PH, which is at high speed. And here, what is plot, what you see in the plot is one permanent magnet machine, which was our reference machine. So the blue one, or the light blue one. In orange, you see one induction machine. In the yellow, you see another induction machine. So starting from the left, if we focus on corner points, we see that for the peak performance, the permanent machine is right there, is just right there, while the induction machine is delivering much more. On the continuous, we have a different picture. None of the three machines are there. At medium speed, what we see is basically that we can achieve peak and continuous with both machines. But we see a different behavior. So the induction machine starts to go down faster in terms of peak performance, but not in terms of continuous performance. In terms of continuous performance, the picture is completely different. The PM machine is starting to die, allow me to say, in a much faster way. That brings to the point that at 70% of the maximum speed, The permanent magnet machine cannot make it, while the induction machine can make it. At high speed, the picture is again different. So here, the peak performance can be achieved by only the permanent magnet machine. So in summary, what I want to see and show and allow us to think together about is based on which is our requirement right now and what we have right now in mind. For example, let's assume one person from the audience is developing a boost secondary axle that needs to deliver the highest torque at low speed, and that's the only key. The easy conclusion would be that induction machine can be better and also price competitive. But what about we need to care at high speed, peak performance? Then the picture would be completely different. And what about we focus at middle speed? But what about this secondary axle need to provide continuous performance? The picture would be again different. So what I want to leave and to conclude my speech with is really from the same picture, from exactly the same picture, which is what we all have in front of us, each of us will get a different takeout. And there is not right, there is not wrong takeout. Different points of view leads to different conclusions, even if we are looking at the same picture. So that's all from my side. Thank you.